Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to a special edition in our Workplace Spotlight series on Agile Payroll practices to support your organization during COVID-19. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing our speakers and periodically jumping in to review some polls. We'll begin with a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. And since there are so many online today, and I know many more of us are working remotely right now, I wanted to call out a couple of extra resources in case anyone starts having audio problems or other technical problems. Please see the webcast helpful hints next to the presentation slides. And there is also a question mark help widget at the bottom of your screen that will link you to common solutions to technical problems. And lastly, I would recommend that if you are on a company network or VPN, if there's any way you could temporarily log off of that, I would recommend that you do that as well if possible. And while we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And lastly, you should also see a list of resources available next to the presentation slides that I would like to highlight. You'll see a PDF of this presentation that's available for download, and our ADP Employer Preparedness Toolkit, where you're going to find FAQs, articles, and additional webinars in our series on FFCRA and the CARES Act that you can watch on demand at any time. Today's webcast is certified for HRCI, SHRM, and CPE credit. For CPE credit, ADP partners with Walters Kluwer for our CPE learning program. As a reminder, for those that want CPE credit, you will need to respond to all four polling questions that we will have throughout the session to qualify. And going to the link on the screen lets you manage all your courses and access your certificates. I would encourage you to download the presentation slides in the resource area as well, as we have an additional slide at the end to serve as instruction on how to access certification. And your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email sent out 24 hours after the event. Also, I'd like to quickly review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice. Before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we're discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics. Regulations and legislation change, and employers need to comply with current laws. And also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has over 60,000 employees and over 600,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance responsibilities. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speakers, Sushma Tripathi and Mary Schaefer. Sushma brings more than 20 years of experience in leadership, operations, and product management in workforce management, payroll, compensation, and benefit strategy, compliance, and administration. She is a recognized authority and a noted speaker at industry conferences and events, a frequent contributor to ADP blogs, and widely published in news outlets. Mary brings more than 20 years of marketing leadership with expertise in change management, communications, marketing, events, executive, and employee communications programs. She is a frequent speaker at conferences, a member of ADP Women in Leadership, a regular contributor to ADP blogs and client publications. With that, Sushma, I know you and Mary have a lot to talk about today, so I'm going to turn the event over to you.
Well, thank you, Karen, and hello and welcome, everyone. Our topic today is Agile Payroll Practices to Support Your Organizational during your organization during COVID-19. Now, we have a rich agenda today, and we will start with organizational agility and business resiliency. And then we will review leading practices for Agile Payroll and associated business impact as it pertains to several items. For example, you know, things like direct deposit, pay cards, touchless pay, electronic W-2s, and then the use of mobile apps. Now, we will close with helpful information on communication, education, and change management. So with that, let's get started by reviewing some of the key HR, payroll, and business considerations. Now, today's landscape continues to present new challenges for business leaders who must balance the interests of customers and the safety and well-being of their staff. Now, we've been in the midst of COVID-19 for more than a month, and employers like yourself continue to focus on maintaining a safe and secure workplace. Now, whether your employees are working on-site or remotely or even from home, you need to continue to make sure that your employees are aware of applicable health and safety policies, including any recent updates due to COVID-19, as well as any changes to your teams, your departments, and reporting relationship, among other things. Now, additionally, you're concerned about business continuity as things change, and most of you have already taken steps to ensure that. Also, to the extent possible, for most employers, essential business operations continue as you experience increased inquiries regarding leave of absence, as well as receive actual requests for leaves for reasons including school closures and employees needing time off to care for their children. Now, other considerations include monitoring your IT infrastructure for increased volume due to telecommuting. This is also, you know, a huge concern for employers. And finally, as you need to continue to be making these decisions in the context of applicable laws and regulations, including executive orders and recommended practices, for example, social distancing, et cetera, to minimize exposure to potential liabilities. Now, employers need to stay flexible but compliant, especially with federal, state, and local laws, you know, governing things like wage and hour, leave, privacy, and discrimination in the workplace. In the meantime, employee engagement and productivity goals, they continue to be of importance. So the right proactive message, one that demonstrates balance, resolve, transparency, and a commitment to people's well-being, that can go a long way towards mitigating these risks. And Mary will talk more about this in just a bit. So with that in mind, let's take a look at some of the trends that have transformed the concept of worker pay. Now, in the past, the concept of pay only existed in the form of employer-oriented solutions. This is rapidly changing now into a worker-centric model that better engages and supports today and tomorrow's workers. Now, the main transformation that we have observed is multifaceted and spans demographic, technological, and economic trends. In general, these trends have put tremendous pressure on organizations around how they are going to handle pay. And that is why pay has become such a hot topic with both HR and payroll executives. So let's take a look at traditional versus employee-centric model and how it is different based on worker demographics. Now, most employers have a multi-generational workforce, and just a couple of months ago, before the COVID-19 crisis, we were concerned about the retiring baby boomers and not having enough Gen Xers to take their place. As a result, most employers were seeing an increase in millennials in the workplace. Also, Gen Zs are now over 21 and increasingly in the workplace. Now, they have different expectations as they have never known a world without technology. In addition to that, the gig economy was flourishing and popular amongst both millennials and Gen Zs. Also, it's important to note that different generations have different expectations around how they are paid and how they manage their finances. In fact, according to the Evolution of Pay study by ADP Research Institute, employees are not only concerned about how much they are paid for work, but also how they receive their pay and how often they receive their pay. Therefore, worker pay and pay options are top of mind. Now, in a traditional employer-oriented model, most of the baby boomers and Gen Xers are working for a single employer. Their pay is generally scheduled. It can be weekly, biweekly, semi-monthly, or monthly, and is employer-initiated. Now, most employees have a bank account, and they receive direct deposit or sometimes even a paper check. Now, on the other hand, in the new worker-centric model, we have millennials and Gen Zs who have traditional employment as well as perform gig work. They are pragmatic, tech-savvy, and value flexibility. In fact, most of them manage 50% of their life on the phone, including online shopping, where, you know, we see billions of dollars are transacted on smartphones worldwide. Now, we know that our society is becoming cashless, and good examples are your parking spots, Starbucks, sporting arenas, etc., and there's a shift to mobile wallets. And it is important to note that in an employee-centric model, the expectation is that worker pay is worker-initiated. It can be off-cycle. It can also be available early. It also provides alternatives for unbanked or underbanked employees. So there's an expectation for employers that the method of payment you provide must interact with different payment options that you see on your screen, and they are basically direct deposit, checks, mobile wallets, PayPal, Venmo, pay cards, and bill pay. Now, we all are familiar with these. Now, another thing to think about is that if your employees are unbanked and receive a paper check, how do they operate in a cashless society? Now, these are the going concerns for employers, and we will cover more on that later today. Next, you also have to consider the economics and changing worker preferences. Gig workers have the expectation of getting paid more often, sooner, with more flexibility. All of this is putting pressure on organizations and changing the way people look at pay. In fact, there's a big shift in the world of pay, where it was traditionally shaped and dictated by the employer's need, and it is now rapidly changing into being centered around what workers want. So with that in mind, let's review market trends and consumer behavior and how they are shifting payment expectations. Now, let me start with a scenario here. Say we've got, you know, two 19-year-old college kids who take an Uber together. Now, Uber will let them split the cost of the ride, but since one doesn't have her app configured yet, the other covers the extra share. And say her friend immediately Venmos her the money to pay her back. Now, for the driver, say it's his last ride for the night, and the girls, you know, as they walk away from the car to their college apartments, the driver uses his app to get paid immediately for his rides for the evening. Now, this scenario is not uncommon. It happens all the time, and you can see how everything is split, settled, and fully paid, all from their respective phones. And the experience is so simple, it's instantaneous, and feels so natural, just like making a phone call. So let me ask you this. Can you imagine one of these kids saying, let me write you a check, and I will, and you know, the check's gonna clear in a few days? Well, that seems pretty unlikely. So the moral of the story is that consumers' expectations of payments are rapidly shifting. We pay each other with Venmo in real time. We order our $5 no-foam double-shot lattes from our phone and pick it up without stopping by the register. And then when we do stop by to pay, we double-tap our Apple Watch, touching it to the point-of-sale device, and we're done. It's as simple as that. Now, these solutions are driving us, especially the millennials and Gen Zs, to de-emphasize traditional banks and cash. Instead, we rely on virtual accounts from non-traditional fintechs and our phones playing the role of banks and cash, which is very different from what we did 2 or 3 years ago. And at the same time, the workforce is shifting. Half of the global workforce will be millennials in a few years. In fact, 47% of millennials and Gen Z workers prefer pay cards over traditional banks. So with that said, let's shift gears and look at additional challenges some of your employees may be faced with. So as worker expectations shift, the payment of wages will be subject to the same expectations. Now, this is an opportunity for employers to modernize their offering and to differentiate by putting people first. We see these expectations from three dimensions, and you're looking at those on your screen. It's basically speed, access, and engagement. Now, in terms of speed, workers want to know, how quickly can I get my pay? Perhaps to cover an emergency bill, or perhaps just because they want it. As a result, employers need to consider offering on-demand pay, which offers faster access and provides flexible choices to workers to receive wages. And then, when it comes to accessing pay, employee expectation is, how and where do I receive my pay? In general, employers need to customize payment options to employees' pay preferences. Now, this will help them remain competitive in hiring and retaining employees. And finally, regarding engagement, employee expectation is, you know, how do I engage with my employer and how can I manage my own finances? As a result, employers need to consider offering financial wellness solutions to raise productivity and engagement. Now, it's important to note that workers are seeing additional delivery methods for their pay. For example, you know, but not exclusively, those that are actually getting a live check. Now, this is because checks carry enormous friction and fees. It includes going to the bank or maybe even a check casher or a payday lender to get cash, loading it onto your debit cards to make the non-cash payments. And, you know, no one really has time for that. So with that in mind, let's talk about what are we hearing. Now, COVID-19 has changed the world. For businesses, it has created dramatic lulls and spike in customer volume and labor needs. Organizations across many industries are stepping up to adjust their current business models to support the needs of their communities and the country. Good examples are your car manufacturers now producing ventilators, you know, your fashion houses making masks, and distilleries making hand sanitizers. This is surreal. Now, we are also seeing drastic economic shift with layoffs and or furloughs across industries, including retail, hospitality, airlines, etc. And then, on the other hand, certain industries are experiencing increased demand, therefore they are hiring. Good examples include online retailers, grocery stores, pharmacies, and delivery services where some employers are willing to pay even more to get the job done. Now, employers are looking for guidance and best practice, and I don't have to remind you that all of this impacts payroll. So with that in mind, let's take a look at the focus areas for payroll operations. Now, this is a quick refresher, and here you're looking at the core focus areas for payroll operations. It starts with your new hires. It's fair to say that hiring trends are specific to industry, and if you're still hiring new employees, as a result, you need to worry about collecting your W-4s and your benefit elections, the four deductions, you know, whether they are pre- or post-tax deductions, in order to process payroll. And then for most employers, you still need oversight and control. You need to capture all the time work for your non-exempt employees and track sick leave, PTO, FMLA, et cetera, for all your employees. You also have to calculate employees' wages and make payments, as well as process any changes. For example, you know, change in employment status, including moving from full-time to a part-time status due to reduction in hours, or make an address change that can impact payroll taxes, or even process a termination and calculate final pay. And that is not it. There is more. Now, in addition to time collection and pay that I just mentioned a minute ago, there are several key components that you see on your screen. For example, there's wage garnishment processing, there's PTO accruals, deduction in arrears, multi-jurisdictional requirements, especially that may or may not be that important these days since most people are not traveling. Also, there's net to gross processing, you know, out of sequence payroll, timely payment of wages, and more. Unfortunately, we don't have time to go over all of these in details, but you get the picture. In addition to that, you need to perform your daily, weekly, monthly, quarterly audits and reconciliation with finance, and also provide data to update general ledger. And that's not it. You also have to consider compliance. Now, it's fair to say that payroll is one of the most regulated functions in an organization. And the requirement is that you pay employees accurately and in a timely manner. Now, this sounds simple, but it's not. You need to make sure you meet the federal, state, and local jurisdictional requirements, including wage and hour laws and federal, state, and local minimum wage requirements. Make sure you classify your employees correctly, both exempt versus non-exempt, especially as employees' duties may be changing these days. Also, make sure that you adhere to federal and state overtime requirements for your non-exempt employees, meals and rest break requirements, and regular rate of pay calculation. You also have to consider existing laws, for example, paid sick leave and paid family leave, etc. Also, have a process in place for tax withholding, reporting, as well as remittance. This includes regular pay, tips, commissions, bonuses, vacation pay, etc. Make sure you maintain a compliance calendar that includes important payroll filing dates and information including filing dates for W-2s and 941. Also, when to distribute those W-2s, 1095Cs, 1099 miscellaneous, also semi-weekly or monthly depositor schedule to deposit your Social Security, Medicare, and withheld income tax, and next business day deposit if your payroll tax obligation is $100,000 or more, which can actually occur if you're paying a bonus check or issuing certain types of stocks. Now, in terms of other deductions, make sure you accurately withhold from wages any child support and garnishment amounts, student loan debt, tax levy, etc. And then don't forget to adhere to security and privacy laws, including mailing information to the right individual, because HIPAA and HITECH Act still apply. And finally, make sure you meet wage statement requirements. Now, the Fair Labor Standards Act, or the FLSA, it does not require an employer to provide employees with pay stubs. However, it does require that employers keep accurate records of hours worked and wages paid to the employees. In addition to FLSA, there are state-specific wage statement requirements that pose compliance issues as well as risks. So make sure you're adhering to all of those requirements as well. Now, you know, this is just a sampling, and as you can imagine, there's more, and we can actually spend hours on compliance alone. So the bottom line is that managing payroll is complex, even under normal operating conditions. So unexpected events like the COVID-19 definitely add to the mix. Now, we had three stimulus packages so far, and several requirements, including ones associated with the Families First Coronavirus Response Act, or the FFCRA. The FFCRA was signed into law on March 18th of 2020 and generally requires employers with less than 500 employees to provide a certain amount of paid sick and paid family leave to employees affected by COVID-19. It also provides affected employers with corresponding employment tax credit. Now, in addition to the FFCRA, it also expands the FMLA, or the Family and Medical Leave Act, requires, to provide protection to your employees. And then also it contains three sections, specifically your emergency FMLA expansion, your emergency paid sick leave, and tax credit associated with both of them, your paid sick leave as well as your paid FMLA. And then on March 27, 2020, the Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security CARES Act was signed. Now, the CARES Act had several provisions, including employer tax, retirement, paid leave, unemployment insurance provision, as well as direct payment to individuals provision. Now, this is an expansive 880 pages bill. And, you know, we've covered a lot of this in webinars, like Karen mentioned to you at the top of the session. So again, we're not going to go into details, but again, from a payroll perspective, you definitely have to think about that as well. And finally, we would like to remind everyone that COVID-19 situation is dynamic. With new governmental measures each day, employers should consult with internal or external counsel for the latest development and updates on and guidance on this topic. Also, you know, one final reminder that be aware that due to COVID-19, some of the state agencies, they've begun offering employers relief for late filing of withholding returns and late payment of withholding taxes, among other things. In addition, certain cities that have predictive scheduling laws temporarily have suspended required predictability pay. So, you know, with that, let's switch gears and rewind in time and do a little bit of comparison then versus now. So a picture is worth a thousand words. For those of you who've been around, you can see the difference in how things have evolved. Now, we punched in and out back then versus now, we are using sophisticated biometrics and mobile devices. We received paper checks back then, and now we have direct deposit, we have pay cards, touchless pay, electronic W-2s with the ability to even view our pay statement, and W-2s online or even through a mobile app. In terms of managing our money, back then, hiding your savings under the mattress or a jar was a thing, versus now using mobile to split your pay into checking and savings account is a common phenomenon. Now, technology and tools have definitely evolved and helped. So with that in mind, let's review some of the leading practices. Now, we know and acknowledge that everyone is going through a difficult time. And the organizations I've spoken with recently, they tell me that some of their main concerns are the emotional and physical well-being of the employees, including their ability to keep everyone connected to the workplace, and also how to keep their business running during the periods of disruption that they're facing. In addition, for HR and payroll, you know that your people will need to get paid and have access to their health benefits and their time off when they need it. So make sure that your employees report time, meaning you have accurate time capture and absence management tools to help employees access and manage their time accurately. If you're using paper and manual processes, make sure you maintain traceability and store all of the documentation appropriately. You also need to maintain benefits eligibility, especially when you change employees from full-time to part-time status, and also when your part-time employees, you know, their hours flex up or down. Make sure you're following the ACA guidelines for benefits eligibility. You know, those are still 30 hours per week or 130 hours per month, and that rule still applies, and you have to offer coverage to all eligible employees. Now, if your employees lose coverage for any reason, make sure you offer them COBRA coverage. And don't forget to encourage direct deposit and pay cards for the unbanked employees. And Mary will provide you with additional best practices on this in just a bit. Also, remember to use your self-service tools to manage work life virtually and leverage technology to improve employee and manager experience. Remember to leverage mobile capabilities whenever appropriate. For example, your W-2, your pay statement, you know, clocking in and out, requesting leave, checking your PTO balance, etc. Encourage self-service whenever possible. Also provide direct deposit, enrollment access, and access to wage statements and W-2s electronically, and communicate early and often to keep employees in the know. And finally, provide access to policies and procedures, including your employee handbook online. Make sure that your policies and procedures are up to date, and they actually reflect any changes related to COVID-19 that you have made, may have made recently. So with that said, let's go to our first polling question. And the question is, do you consider your HR payroll department agile? Please select one of the four responses listed on your screen. Your choices are yes, no, maybe, and if you're unsure, please select unsure. You have 30 seconds to respond, and the clock starts now.
Thank you so much, Sushma. And yes, as she said, at this point, you should all be seeing the first polling question on your screen. I'm going to give my first CPE reminder. For those of you that would like CPE credit, to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. And if for some reason you're not seeing the question on your screen and in your slide area, you can feel free to use the Q&A text box to answer. And I'll repeat here right now the question and answer. So the question is, do you consider your HR payroll department agile? And your possible responses are yes, no, maybe, or unsure. Let me give you just a couple more seconds. Okay, Sushma, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Well, thank you, Karen. And that is interesting because it seems like most of you, in fact, almost 60% of you believe you're agile. And these days, everybody has to be agile. You know, a few people have said no, and some people are on the fence, 22% maybe, and 9.2% unsure. So, you know, for those of you who are unsure or on the fence, you know, how do you become agile? Let's take a look at that. So, you know, you can start by defining agile for your company. If your company were more agile, what would you do differently? Better customer listening, redesign customer relationship, use new technology or service models, innovate versus adapt, and, you know, think about it. How would outcomes be different? Well, So the answer to these questions needs to be specific and relevant to your business. And then you need to understand the barriers as well as the enablers, meaning what prevents you from being agile today? Is it organizational skills and capabilities or lack of collaboration and communication? Is it rigid policies and practices? How about maintenance of legacy products and services? You know, is that kind of adding weight to you? Or is it budgetary constraints? So you need to think about what aspects of your workplace culture needs to change and what stays the same. So, you know, this is not easy. It's complex. And in order to do all of this, you need to start evaluating and understanding the market environment and your business strategy. With COVID-19, the current landscape presents many challenges and opportunities for employers to review or enhance business continuity planning, as well as, you know, your workforce well-being and corporate reputation. So this is a good time to assess your organizational capabilities, your HR and payroll practices, tools and technology, as well as skill set. Now, as I mentioned before, payroll is more mission critical these days than ever. While many businesses' functions slow down during times like these, workers still need to get paid. So remember, decisive and empathetic leadership with agility in adjusting HR policies and creating clear, timely communications are critical to successfully managing through these difficult times. And with that in mind, let's look at agile payroll practices. Now, by definition, agile is the ability to change direction efficiently and effectively. And when agile is used in a business context, we often break it down into its components, perception and response. We perceive our environment and we respond. So here's a little bit of a history on agile. You know, it started as a software development methodology around a decade or so ago. And it's popular now and used mostly by IT departments. The approach is to use cross-functional team collaboration for rapid prototyping, refining, validating, and deploying software. Now, this includes division of tasks into short phases for work and frequent reassessment and adaptation to deliver the next iteration to the end users and customers. Now, we find that more, you know, now more than ever, organizations are becoming agile. As a result, HR and payroll is under pressure to deliver results in a rapidly changing work environment, just like what you're doing today. Now, with COVID-19, teams, departments, and business units must be nimble as they continually shift gears and pivot. This applies to payroll as well. So agile payroll practices refer to the ability of the payroll department to perceive and respond to change rapidly. This includes people, process, and technology. So the key question you have to ask yourself is that, does your payroll department have the right tools, skills, policies, and practices needed in order to be agile? Now, the right culture and skills can make a huge difference and can inspire confidence, eliminate mistakes, and help boost productivity. So focus on what decisions can you make now that will improve your relationship with your employees and customers when this pandemic is behind us. If you expect that your company may have to alter or modify its offering, consider communicating that to your customers as early as possible to maintain your brand's reputation. And your customers include your employees as well. So at the end of the day, organizational success really depends on agility. Now, in fact, popular cultural frameworks don't always tie directly to organizational agility. Even hierarchical organizations can possess agility. So here's a reminder for you. You know, cultural style is less important than specific company values and practices. For example, your future-focused processes, valuing innovation, transparency, creativity, diversity and collaboration, also having tolerance for learning from failure, prioritizing knowledge sharing, among other things. All of these can be valuable. And there's no one type of culture that is distinctively agile. In fact, we are all having to become agile as we respond to COVID-19. And there are specific behaviors that can inhibit or promote open collaboration and agility. For example, Is it common in your organization to set clear goals and expectations? Are roles and responsibilities clearly defined? And what about psychological safety and dependability? Are diverse point of views welcome? And what about trust within team members? How about intolerance for mistakes or questioning a supervisor's direction? Now, it's better to emphasize simple, basic behaviors and eliminate toxic behavior rather than trying to teach people how to be agile. So the bottom line is that organizational agility, it requires personal stability. Now, your employees need to have clear direction. They need to know what is expected of them, and at the end of the day, it is better to focus on the outcomes you want and make small, everyday adjustments to actually get there. Now, this could include encouraging your employees to go paperless or use direct deposit, use pay cards, electronic W-2s, and access information online and via mobile app. These are just a few examples. So this brings us to our second polling question, and the question is, do you think your employees want paper checks? You have three choices. They are very simple: yes, no, or unsure. And just like before, you have 30 seconds to respond, and the clock starts now.
Thank you again so much, Sushma. So at this point, you should be seeing the second polling question on your screen. And I'm also going to give my second CPE reminder for those of you that would like credit to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. And just to repeat, your question is, do you think your employees want paper checks? And your possible responses are yes, you think they do. No, you think they do not want paper checks. Or you are unsure. And I'm going to give you all just a few more seconds to respond. Okay, Sushma, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Okay, and this is amazing. You know, most of you, in fact, 87.2% of you have said no. And, you know, let me tell you that according to the ADP Research Institute in North America, more than 50% of the employers still offer paper checks. As shown, you know, in the chart that you're looking at right now, you can see that, you know, only 9% of the employees receive paper checks today, and just 4% of the employees say they prefer them, which is interesting and consistent with what, you know, all of you have said. So now with that, I will pass it on to Mary, who will cover direct deposit with you.
Thank you, Sushma. And certainly the current situation of social distancing is driving the importance of things like direct deposit and alternative touch-free pay options. With direct deposit, your employees can receive their pay by having it transferred electronically into a savings or checking account of their choosing. And in these uncertain times, and really during any time, your employees need to know how to access their pay and benefits information and how to get that information without having to leave their home. Now, while the concept of direct deposit may not be new to you, it might be new to certain portions of your populations, say for those who have traditionally received a live paper check, or new hires, for example. And here's an interesting fact. We see here that 67 million people are currently unbanked or underbanked and are using alternative financial products like check cashing services. There is an opportunity to promote direct deposit and other pay options to reach these populations as well. So if you haven't already, it makes sense to make sure that your employees are aware of this as an option. How can you promote direct deposit? Today we're going to cover this in five steps. For your employees who do have a bank account, let's talk about how your organization can drive direct deposit adoption. First, take a look at your current state. Are you able to pull the data from your system that shows how many of your employees are using direct deposit today? From there, you can secure a list of those employees who are not enrolled and use that to target your communications campaign to them. And work with your payroll provider to see if there are tools available for things like self-service through a portal or mobile app, as Sushma mentioned earlier. Next, understand who you're communicating with and identify how they like to receive information. Consider the portion of your workforce today that are working from home, as well as your employees who may still be going into a plant, warehouse, or office location, and how to effectively reach them. You'll also want to determine the right time to deploy messages, and you can do this by partnering with your executives, HR, legal, and marketing teams to confirm timing and tone of the messages. Next, you'll want to think about the most important points that you need to convey to your employees regarding what's in it for me, because ultimately that's what people care about. You know, what is this? How is it going to impact me? Why should I do it? Right now, the message is simple. No need to leave your house to receive your pay in a world where social distancing is critical to flattening the curve. You'll also want to utilize a variety of communications deliverables. For example, email, a portal, manager communications, onboarding information, et cetera. And keep in mind that it takes multiple times to deliver a message before it's understood and acted on. You also want to tap into your HR leaders and people managers to help get the word out. Last, be sure to measure the effectiveness of your direct deposit campaign by reviewing your payroll data and monitoring enrollments, and refine your communications approach from there as needed, and reinforce your messages year-round, not just right now. And the same goes for any communications about pay and benefits, options that are available to your employees. Communications, much like payroll, is an ongoing process. And for those employees who aren't today, they don't have a bank account, let's talk about an alternative option, and that's the use of pay cards. Here you see the average bank user pays around $500 in fees annually. That's a lot of money. And those banking fees can be avoided by your employees if they move to something like a pay card. For those of you who aren't familiar, a pay card is a prepaid card onto which an employer loads an employee's wages or salary each payday. Pay cards are another alternative to direct deposit or paper checks. Your employees can choose the amount or percentage of pay that they want loaded onto the card. So some employees choose to receive some pay on a card and some pay via direct deposit. It really depends on personal preferences. And with a pay card, users can also access their money from an ATM or cashback purchase in the same way that they can use a traditional debit card, which is another option for populations that may not have a formal banking arrangement, or really for anyone looking for flexibility in how they receive their wages, especially right now. Pay cards can also eliminate the need to go to an office location or a work site to pick up a live check. No need to worry about having to leave your home during shelter-in-place orders or while social distancing is in play. So now let's talk about another pay option, and that's touchless. In the midst of COVID-19, we're all focused on social distancing and minimizing contact with high-touch areas and surfaces, like the keypad at the grocery store, for instance. More and more grocery stores and other essential businesses like banks are turning to touchless pay for safer, touch-free transactions. In fact, I was just at the grocery store the other day, and before I left my house with my mask and gloves, I downloaded their app, put my credit card information into it, so I could take advantage of touchless pay from now on, and it was super easy to do. And it's really no surprise that the move to touchless reflects public health concerns related to coronavirus. And there are also mobile wallet options like Apple Pay, Google Pay, Samsung Pay, which allow users to simply hold their phone near a payment terminal to complete a transaction, much like the example Sushma gave earlier about Starbucks. This also negates the need to swipe a traditional credit or debit card and increases the number of contactless payment options available to consumers. We certainly expect this to trend up as businesses continue to look for ways to keep both workers and customers safe. Let's move to our third polling question, which is, how do you provide access to wage statements and W-2s? Your choices are paper copy, website and mobile, or a combination. We'll give you 30 seconds to respond, and then we'll check out the results.
Thank you so much, Mary. So as she stated, at this point, you should be seeing the third polling question on your screen. And I'll also give my third CPE reminder for those of you that would like credit to please make sure you do respond to the question to qualify, and I will repeat it for you. It is, how do you provide access to wage statements and W-2s? Your possible responses are paper copy, website and mobile, or a combination of those. I'm going to give you all just a few more seconds to give you time to respond. Okay, Mary, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Okay, thank you very much. It looks like just a few of you are still having paper copies, 12%, 10% on a website, 22% on a combo. So that's very consistent with what we're seeing, and we're seeing this with a lot of other employers that we're working with. So with that in mind, let's take a look at electronic W-2s. So having an electronic W-2 available through, an easy-to-use, secure website will make it easier for your employees, especially in this day and age where phishing is also a concern. Online delivery also eliminates the chance that your W-2 statement will get lost, misdirected, or even delayed during delivery or after receipt. We all know things can get misplaced, so it's nice to have an electronic option, and those records can also stay online for many years. And with electronic access, your employees can easily download it into many tax preparation software programs. The bottom line here is that receiving an electronic W-2 form is safer, faster, and greener. And this was the week that taxes are typically due, just the other day on Wednesday, but not this year. It's been delayed to July 15th. So some of your employees who have delayed tax filing, they still have time, if you have paperless W-2s as an option, to download that to complete their taxes. Now let's talk a little bit about HR and mobile apps. With COVID-19 and the prevalence of social distancing, it makes sense to see if your HR or payroll provider currently offers a mobile app as part of the user experience. These apps offer a convenient way for employees to see their key payroll, time, benefits, and even pay card balance on demand. Or if you're in a situation where you have an off-cycle benefits open enrollment period, or you're trying to onboard a new hire, or even empower an employee to declare a life event, say the birth of a child or a marriage, having employee self-service and or a mobile app can really help get the job done without having to be on the job site. And with so many employees working from home, this is another easy way for them to access their important information anywhere and anytime. Having an app for work life also helps underscore the points that Sushma made earlier about people wanting information via apps and conducting half their lives online. Let's move to our fourth and final polling question, which is related to communications. A message needs to be communicated at least 7 times for information to be understood and acted on. Your choices are true or false. We'll give you 30 seconds again, like last time, and then we'll take a look at the results.
Thank you so much, Mary. And yes, this is our final polling question for the session today. So also give my final reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. And this is a simple true-false one. The statement is, a message needs to be communicated at least 7 times for information to be understood and acted on. So is that statement true or is that statement false? I'm going to give you about 5 more seconds. Okay, Mary, you should see the results on the screen now.
Look at this, 67.2% of you are exactly right. It does take an average of 7 times for a message to be understood and acted on. It's called the rule of 7. So thank you for your weighing in on that. Let's talk a little bit about communications and how to get started. So far, we've reviewed a lot of leading practices for agile payroll and associated business impact as it relates to things like direct deposit, pay cards, touchless pay, electronic W-2s, and the use of mobile apps. We're going to take a few minutes to cover internal communications around things like pay, benefits, and time. Now, more than ever, employees are looking to their employees for easy access to pay and benefits, and that's why it's so important to have a plan and process in place to reach all of your employees with critical updates. As part of this effort, you'll want to outline your communications channels that you have that you can tap into to reach your employees, things like email, internet postings, flyers, posters, videos, blog posts, if you have things like Yammer or Slack, and FAQs. And also, I suggest having a source of truth resource where employees can go for the latest and greatest information. And that could be a company intranet site or portal, for instance. Next, determine who will deliver the messages. What we're seeing lately from other employers like you is that important information about pay and benefits are coming out of the C-suite, most commonly from the CEO, president, or CHRO of organizations. You'll also want to determine how you'll reach your, what I call, disconnected employees, those without email or mobile access, perhaps those on leave of absence, or others who have accepted offers with your organization, but they haven't started yet. Given all of the implications of COVID-19, you'll also want to partner with legal, HR, and other leadership for timely review and approval of all of your messages and materials before distribution. It's important to support workplace trust by communicating often and with transparency, especially as it relates to pay and benefits and pay options that are available to your workforce. Employees are truly counting on you for information and reassurance. Another step you can take is to designate a point person. So designating a person to stay on top of COVID-19 related developments, help prepare communications, and receive and respond to employee questions is a great idea, especially now. Providing resources to your employees to help them understand things like paperless pay, direct deposit, and the other things we covered earlier today. This could be someone like an HR business partner, an employee call center, or even people managers to help get the word out to all of your frontline team members. Next, establish a clear line of communications for employees who are asking questions and share those general interest questions more broadly, and also make sure that you're listening to your employees and quickly responding to them with information to help make them understand what your policies and answers are from that key point person. And remember, key messaging is important as well. Let's talk about that for a second. Whenever you're communicating about things like pay and benefits to your employees, those are really important and personal to employees. So you have to be really thoughtful and careful in your messaging. State the facts, outline the impact to the business, resources available for them, where to get more information, and anticipate and proactively answer questions. Communications in times of crisis like COVID-19 are critical, and being transparent will really help you support workplace trust. As part of this, employees are looking for ongoing assurance that the organization is safeguarding their pay in addition to safeguarding their health and safety. So review your communications and content for tone and be sensitive to employee concerns and respond in a timely manner. Next, you'll want to clearly articulate your policies. Some of you may have a larger team of practitioners that have expertise in payroll, benefits, time, and payroll. But most of the clients that I work with have a very lean HR or payroll team, and they have to wear many hats. I bet that's the same for a lot of you on the call today. And sometimes that also means that you are the default communications department. So as you're considering communications to your employees as it relates to all things HR, pay, and benefits, be sure that you're clearly outlining work from home, time off, social media, and travel policies, including any changes that you may have made due to the new laws related to COVID-19, including the FFRCA and CARES Act that Sushma mentioned earlier. Clearly outlining your expectations for things like clocking in and out, off-the-clock work, manager approval processes, requesting time off, et cetera. And as Sushma had mentioned earlier, put a copy of your employee handbook out there for people to access easily. Any good communications plan should consider how to prepare each of your stakeholders. For example, your stakeholder groups could include folks like leaders, managers, managers of managers, frontline associates, or even new hires. These are the constituents who must receive timely information about pay and benefits. That said, it's important to prepare your HR partners, managers, and leaders and respond and communicate to employees regarding payroll-related issues. For example, first, make sure all of your employees are being paid accurately and timely. Provide FAQs, talking points, and other relevant information to address questions. and preparing your stakeholders, as I mentioned earlier, to answer questions from employees and have calls with those folks on a regular basis so you can get a pulse on what your employees are asking about, so you can prepare answers to questions that you didn't originally anticipate, and then continue to refine those responses and distribute broadly. And if you're hiring and onboarding new employees, having an electronic system to onboard employees during COVID-19 is a good option for employers so that new hires can fill out forms and submit them online versus having to physically bring them to an office location or job site. Let's take a look at some sample communications. Here you see a few ideas to show you how you can develop content that is designed to grab employees' attention. You'll see examples here about how to promote things like self-service and pay cards, and it's done in a visual manner that's designed to really stand out and not just be an email or a posting to a portal, but really how do you make this more of an internal advertising campaign per se. This next slide shows some additional creative ideas for driving awareness of how employees can access things like a time and attendance system to clock in and out, as well as calling attention to a mobile app where employees can view their pay and other information. Let's quickly touch on some ideas for supporting organizational change. We've talked a lot about best practices in communicating with your workforce, and here's a quick summary that includes a lot of tips for leading practices around supporting organizational change, such as preparing managers, having a team of change champions, focusing in on what's in it for them, all of those things that we touched on earlier. It's important to keep in mind that adjusting to any kind of change takes time, and we're all faced with an unprecedented situation and need to remain agile, including with communications. And on the next slide, this is at a glance, you can see a change management and communications continuum. This is a good model to follow as you're thinking about agile payroll practices to support your organization during COVID-19. I've covered off a lot of these over the course of our conversation, but this is a good at-a-glance to work from as you are preparing to communicate to your organization. As you can see from everything we covered today, organizational agility and business resiliency is key, and we believe that organizations that are seen as doing the right thing by their employees right now will have stronger employee brand and employee loyalty. With that, I'll turn things back to Karen.
Thank you so much, Mary, and Sushma as well, for all of that valuable information. You've definitely given employers a lot to think about today. So unfortunately, based on timing, this does conclude our event for today. And as a reminder, your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email that we send out 24 hours after the event. And if you requested CPE credit when you registered, you should be able to access your CPE credit using the instructions in the presentation within 24 to 48 hours. To receive ongoing communications from ADP on regulatory and legislative guidelines and deadlines, please subscribe to our Ion Washington email alerts by visiting the link shown on the screen or indicate you'd like to opt in on the event survey. And for more workforce trends and insights, we encourage you to visit our Spark blog link shown on the screen. And I would say definitely visit for this topic because I know we will be following up with blog posts regarding this and some of your questions, your commonly asked questions that came out of our session today. And lastly, you can register for additional Workplace Spotlight webinars, such as the special edition ones I mentioned at the beginning of the session on FFCRA and the CARES Act using the link shown on the screen. And on behalf of Sushma, Mary, myself, and the entire team at ABP, we thank you for joining us today and look forward to having you join us for future Workplace Spotlight events. Thank you again, and I hope everyone stays safe out there.